Yes, please sing with us. Get your Bible and let's study God's Word together. All the difference that Jesus can make in our lives. Amen? Amen. He is worth worshiping today. Praise the Lord. Oh, we love you, Lord.
We've waited for this day. We're gathered in your name, calling out to you. Your glory like a fire, awakening desire, will burn our hearts with truth. You're the reason we're here. You're the reason we're singing. Open up the heavens. We want to see you open up the floodgates. A mighty river flowing from your heart. Oh, you're feeling every part of our praise. Your glory's in this place, Lord. Your glory's on our face. We're looking to the sky. Oh, yes, descending like a cloud. You're standing with us now, Lord, unveil our eyes. You're the reason we're here. You're the reason we're singing. Oh, open up the heavens. We want to see you open up the floodgates. A mighty river flowing from your heart. And you're feeling every part of our praise. Open up the heavens. We want to see you open up the floodgates. A mighty river flowing from your heart. For you're feeling every part of our praise.
Make this your prayer.
Show us your glory.
Please, Lord,
show us your power. Oh, show us your glory, Lord.
Oh, don't just sing it. Make that our prayer today. Show us, God.
Show us your glory. Show us your power. Oh, show us your glory, Lord.
We want to see you open up the floodgates.
I want to see you open up the floodgates. A mighty river flowing from your heart. Oh, you're feeling every part of our praise. Open up the heavens. We want to see you open up the floodgates. A mighty river flowing from your heart. And feeling every part of our praise.
Show us your glory. Show us your power. Show us your glory, Lord.
We want to see you. Show us
your glory. Show us your power. Show us your glory, Lord.
Show us, God. Show us
your glory. Show us your power.
Yes,
show us your glory, Lord.
Oh, make yourself known to us, Lord.
Show us your glory. Show us your power. Show us your glory, Lord.
Give him praise. Give him glory. Praise the Lord. Amen.
Come, let us worship our King.
Come, let us bow at his feet, for he has done great things.
See what our Savior has done. See how his love overcomes. Oh, he has done great things. He has done great things. Oh, hero of heaven, you conquer the grave. You free every captive and break every chain. Oh, God, you have done great things. We dance in your freedom, awake at the light. Oh, Jesus, our Savior, your name lifted high.
Yes, he has. Amen. Amen. He's in the great thing business. Amen.
You've been faithful through every storm. You'll be faithful forevermore. You have done great things. And I know you will do it again. For your promise is yes and amen. You will do great things. God, you do great things. Oh, hero of heaven, you conquer the grave. You free every captive and break every chain. Oh, God, you have done great. Your freedom, awake.
Oh, Jesus,
our Savior, your name lifted high. Oh, God, you have done great things. Oh, hallelujah, God, above it all. Hallelujah, God, unshakable. Hallelujah, God, above it all. Hallelujah, God, unshakable. Hallelujah, you have done great things. You've done great things. Oh, hero of heaven, you conquer the grave. You free every captive and break every chain. Oh, God, done great things. We dance in your freedom, awake and alive. Oh, Jesus, our Savior, your name lifted high. Oh, God, you have done great things. You have done great things. You have done great.
Give the Lord praise. Give him glory. Brother Rob.
Praise the Lord. I want to welcome everyone this morning. What a glorious morning it is to be in the house of the Lord. I want to welcome everyone here. Oh, Donovan, I was talking to Heather this morning. I said, what can we do to get Donovan back in the house of the Lord? Now, Donovan, for you who don't know, he works the late shift. So by the end of the day, this is the beginning of our day. It's the end of his day. So praise God that you're here. Praise God. What an answer. An answer right immediately. Praise God that he's here. And not to mention, we have other church members that are from Missouri here on this front row. So praise God for all the things that the Lord's doing in our house. Today's a good morning. And I want to make an announcement. It's a little bit of a selfish announcement, but I think it is something that would bless your heart. It's blessed my heart. We're doing a discipleship class at 5 o'clock this evening. Now, we're doing that for the next, I guess, 11 more Sundays. And this discipleship class is one of those things where it's the fundamentals of Christianity. It's those essentials that we need to know as Christians. Today's message is going to be how to know that you know that you know that you're saved. To have a know-so a no-so type of relationship with God. You know, it seems like in our lives, we go about our lives, and we know Christians. We have friends that have walked their entire journey, but they're not assured of their salvation. The Bible tells us how we can know that we should know that we should know. So we're going to answer those questions. It'll be a little interactive today. We're going to be able to talk a little bit about it. And by the end of the class, I can promise you one thing. We'll know what the Bible tells us about our salvation. And we'll know what the assurance that God gives us through the Word about our salvation. So answers will be given, and it'll be from the Word of God. Now, if you could stand in honor of reading God's Word, I'd like you to turn to Hebrews chapter 7. Hebrews chapter 7, verse 25. Now, I read this scripture probably about 3 or 4 weeks ago, so this will be a repeat for some of you, but it never gets old. Verse 25, therefore, he is able also to save forever those who draw near to God through him, since he always lives to make intercession for them. For it is fitting for us to have such a high priest, holy, innocent, undefiled, separated from sinners, and exalted above all the heavens, who does not need daily, like those high priests, to offer up sacrifices first for his own sins and then for the sins of the people, because he did once for all when he offered up himself. Now, we're talking about Jesus, by the way, if you don't know that. For the law appoints men as high priests who are weak, but the word of the oath, which come after the law, appoints a son made perfect forever. Praise God. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, I thank you for your Son. I thank you that he is a high priest, the great high priest, the only high priest we'll ever need. And I thank you that Jesus Christ can intervene in our lives. He can change us for all eternity. Lord, I pray that we can get that settled tonight. I pray that we can get it settled this morning. I pray for Brother Jim. I pray that as he brings the message this morning, that there will be those that may not know Christ, but may receive him through the message you deliver through your servant. It is in Jesus' name I pray this. Amen.
Let's continue to worship the Lord today. Praise the Lord.
One day when heaven was filled with his praises, one day when sin was as black as could be, Jesus came forth to be born of a virgin, dwelt among men, my example is he. Word became flesh and the light shined among us, his glory revealed. Living he loved me, dying he saved me, buried he came. Stretched out on a tree and took the nails for me.
Oh, one day the trumpet will sound for his coming. One day the skies with his glories will shine. Wonderful day, my beloved one bringing. My Savior Jesus is mine. Living he loved me. Dying he saved me. Buried he carried my sins for away. Oh, rising he justified freely forever. And one day he's coming. Oh, glorious day. Oh, glorious day.
So lay down your burdens, lay down your shame. All who are broken, lift up your face. O wanderer, come home, you're not too far. So lay down your hurt, lay down your heart, come as you are.
There's hope for the hopeless, and all those who stray. Come sit at his table, oh come taste his grace. There's rest for the weary. It's rest that endures. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can cure. So lay down your burdens, lay down your shame. All who are broken, oh, lift up your face. Lay down your heart and come as you are. give the Lord praise, give Him glory. So back in March, we got to go and we did 9 meetings in 4 days at First Baptist Church of Blanchard, Louisiana. And about 3 meetings in, my voice was gone. Most of you want to say, praise the Lord, wish we would have been in Blanchard. Yeah, my voice was gone. But see, my voice has always been my offering for me to give unto the Lord. And suddenly, it was gone. And my job was to lead out in worship. And I tried my best to do the best for the Lord and for those people without my voice. And then it come to this song. This song may not bless you, but it blesses me. And I want to tell you why. Because at that moment, I felt like I had nothing in my hands to bring. So this morning, whether we can sing or whether we can't, whether we can teach or whether we can't, whatever gifts God's given us or whatever gifts we feel like He hasn't given us, you see, at the end of the day, we have nothing that we can offer that is really a great gift for such a King as we serve. Everything we have is because of Jesus. Everything. Even our righteousness that we have is through Christ Jesus. It's not of our own. It's all through Him. And so as we sing this song this morning, I want you to remember, we have nothing but empty hands to bring before a Savior, before the King of this universe, who is willing and ready to accept us as we are. The gift of salvation is there, it is full, and it is free, and it is available to everyone in this room. All we have to do is take it. We love you, Lord. Oh, I approach the throne of glory. Nothing in my hands I bring, but the promise of acceptance from a good and gracious King. Isn't He good and gracious? Oh, I will give to You my burden as You give to me Your. Lord, come and fill me with Your Spirit as I sing to You this praise. You deserve the greater glory. Overcome, I lift my voice to a King in need of. Oh, empty-handed I rejoice. You deserve the greater glory. Overcome with joy I sing. By Your love I am accepted. For You're a good and gracious. Grace that You would see me as Your child and as Your friend. I'm safe, secure in You forever. Oh, I pour out my praise again. You deserve the greater glory. Overcome, I lift my voice.
greater glory. Overcome, I lift my voice to the King in need of nothing. Oh, empty-handed, I rejoice. You deserve the greater glory. Overcome with joy. You're a good and gracious King. You're a good and gracious King. You're a good and gracious.
Give him praise. Give him glory. Amen, amen. You may be seated. Praise the Lord. I can only imagine what it will be like when I walk by your side. I can only imagine what my eyes will see when your face is before me. I can only imagine. I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus? Or in all of you be still? Will I stand in your presence? Or to my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak it all? I can only imagine. I can only imagine. I can only imagine when that day comes and I find myself standing in the sun. I can only imagine. When all I will do is forever, forever worship you. I can only imagine. Yes. Oh, I can only imagine. Oh, surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus? Or in all of you be still? Will I stand in your presence? Or to my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. Yeah. Oh, I can only imagine. Will I dance for you, Jesus? Or in all of you be still? Will I stand in your presence? Or to my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak it all? can only imagine. Yes, oh, I can only imagine. I can only imagine when all I will do is forever, forever worship you. I can only imagine.
Well, God's people said, we can only imagine. Amen, church. What a day that will be. Let's sing that chorus, Brian. What a day that will be, guys, when our Jesus shall see. Let's sing it.
When my Jesus I shall see, and I look upon his face, the one who saved me by his grace, when he takes me by the hand and leads me through the promised land. Oh, what a day, a glorious day that will be.
If you don't do this to Brian, we'll still be here at 12 o'clock. See? Thank you, Jesus. When you got a song in your heart, you got to let it out. Thank you, Brinsky. If you have your Bibles, turn to the book of Revelation, chapter 21. We looked at these verses a number of weeks ago, but we're going to look at it in a different way this morning. Revelation, chapter 21. We hope when you came in this morning, you got an outline. If you're here this morning at Cornerstone, you do not have an outline, would you raise your hand high? We got folks all over the auditorium that need outlines. Where's our men, please? We need outlines. Thank you, Jesus. Over here, God forbid for Goat to get one on the way in. His wife's got one. Anyway, keep your hands up, folks. We need a pen, please. We need pens, please. Chris just threw her husband under the bus. And so, anybody else? Everybody needs to have an outline. Praise the Lord. We welcome those who are watching this morning online from all over the world, literally. At 5:30 this morning, I got a text from Central America. There's a whole house full of folks in Central America that's watching the service right now. They're 1 hour behind us in Central America. I got a text at 5:30. It was 4:30 their time. They're telling me they're going to be watching. The whole house is full of people who want to hear the gospel in America. So those precious people in Central America, we welcome you to Cornerstone Church, and we pray that God's Holy Spirit will move and work in your lives there. Amen, church? Amen. God bless you. Y'all have heard me talk a lot about a couple that's members of this church. They grew up in Catholicism. And they both got gloriously saved here, baptized here, served the Lord here. One of the ways you know they were saved, because they're tithers. These folks moved to Branson, Missouri, and I'm always shouting out to them. And they're here this morning. They came in for Jan and her family's services we had for her daughter yesterday, the funeral services. For her daughter here, they came in from Branson, Missouri. I want y'all to stand. These people support this church with their prayers financially, and may their tribe increase. And while they're doing that, Brother Kent's brother, Bill and Karen Smith, are watching this morning from Rimrock, Arizona. Rimrock, Arizona, they're watching right now. We welcome those folks from Arizona. They want to join the church here. They've been watching online with Kent and Chris. They took their family to Florida a few months ago, and his brother and family came from Arizona, watched the services, and they want to be a part of this fellowship. Amen. Thank God for our online ministry. Amen. Last Sunday night, two people were saved on the online ministry. Amen. To God be the glory. Amen. We welcome all those and welcome you here this morning to our services, and praise the Lord. Heaven is a place of no more forever mores. We, the last several weeks, have lost some of our precious families. Had a funeral yesterday for a 47-year-old girl who passed away, Jan's daughter, Brother Wayne's wife. We've been praying every Sunday for Warren and Marilyn Glover. We saw her 3 weeks ago sitting at the table eating a hamburger, me and Brian and Rob and Brett, healthy, just diagnosed with cancer 3 weeks ago. I saw her Tuesday. She's down to 87 pounds this last Tuesday, and she went home to be with Jesus yesterday. You pray for Brother Warren Glover. Many of you new members, you never had a privilege to meet one of the most Jesus families. They all got saved at First Baptist Church Saxey when I was there, and just a precious family. Jan Botiford's, I saw her yesterday after the funeral. I went to the hospital to see Jan Botiford, who's got cancer, and she's been in terrific pain, and they're trying to get that under control. And Lord willing, she'll move from Richardson Hospital to Garnet Hill for rehab. This message God laid on my heart this last week because of what so many of our people are going through. And it's going to be a message of encouragement. And you're going to hear a song that 99.9% of you have never heard before in a few moments. And I hope it administers you half as much as it's ministered to me. If you've got someone in heaven right now, would you raise your hand? Well, this message is not for them because they're home free. But this message is for us who are still here. Heaven gets sweeter every day. Are y'all out there, please? Wanda Renfro and the Renfro family is watching right now in Mesquite, Texas. Mikey Renfro's mother. Kathy and I were on vacation 1 year, and I flew back twice to bury people that I loved. I won't fly back, won't drive back for everybody. But 1 year I had to fly back to bury one of my deacons who died of a massive heart attack at Smith's Pharmacy in Seagoville. Did his funeral, flew back to where my family was at, was there just a few hours, and one of my deacon's wives had a major stroke, and I flew back. I didn't spend vacation with my family that year. We're leaving after church to go to Rockport, Texas with all of my family, my grandkids, my children. Something we planned for a while, but Brother Warren, I told him I would do Maryland's service, so that means I'll drive back. Because that family means a lot to me. If I was in Israel, and we're going back next year, 52 of our people were here last week going to Israel. 52. If I was in Israel and I got a call from the Renfro family that Wanda went home to be with Jesus, I'd leave Israel and fly back to be with Mikey Renfro. I'm not going to do that for everybody. But Many of these people have ministered to my life and my family's life. And you do what you got to do for Jesus. This message is for me this morning. This is a message for you this morning and everyone online. Because sooner or later, we're going to be walking through that valley. But the good news is when you have Jesus, you don't walk it alone. For yea, though we walk through the valley of the shadow of death, our God's with us. That's good news of the gospel. Let's stand in honor of God's word together, please. Revelation chapter 21, if you got it, say you got it. Please keep your Bibles open because we're going to look at some other verses here in Revelation. Beginning with verse 23. About 4 weeks ago, I preached a message entitled, Jesus, the Light of the City. This is not that message. For those of you who think it is. And the city that had no need of the sun, neither of the moon to shine in it, for the glory of God did lighten it. And the Lamb is the light thereof. And the nations of them which are saved shall walk in the light of it. And the kings of the earth do bring their glory and honor into it. And the gates of it shall not be shut at all by day, for there shall be no night there. I said there'll be no night there. One of these days we'll live in the eternal day. And they shall bring the glory and honor of the nations into it. And there shall be no wise enter into it anything that defileth, neither whatsoever worketh abomination or maketh a lie, but they which are written in the Lamb's book of life. Every head bowed, every eye closed, those home in Central America, Arizona, wherever you may be watching today here at Cornerstone, would you join us this morning in prayer? Everyone praying with me. Dear Jesus, please speak to my heart today. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. When you study the scriptures, you'll find that God has revealed His glory in 6 different ways. I'm going to ask one of our men to bring me some water with no ice, please. 6 ways that God has revealed His glory. Would you write it down? The first time God revealed His glory to man was in His creation. Say amen to that, church. Apparently, you've never been to the Rocky Mountains. Apparently, you've never been to the Smoky Mountains. Apparently, you've never been to Pecos, Texas. Oh, whatever. The heavens declare His glory. Everything that God does, He does for His glory. God revealed His glory, first of all, when He stepped out on nothing and created this universe. He stepped out on nothing and created this universe. I can tell you in 2 words how God created this world. I can tell you in 2 words how God created this world. Are you ready? God said. I need an amen there, please. Would you write down? Thank you, Brother Michael. Everyone say, God said. In Genesis chapter 1, verse 1, 10 times, how many? 10 times the Bible says, and God said. 10 in the Bible is the number of completion. And when God said the final, God said, it was over with. This world was here. Amen. No such thing as evolution in that monkey story. Amen. And God said, when God in the beginning created the heavens and the earth, He revealed His glory in His creation. Number 2, would you write it down? Secondly, he revealed his glory in his chosen people, Israel. Glory in God's chosen people. God in his sovereignty, everybody look up here. God in his sovereignty chose a tiny little country about the size of Rhode Island. Been there 15 times this coming year. Been to one, Dan to Beersheba. It don't take you long to go from Dan to Beersheba. A tiny little country. But God in his sovereignty chose Israel to be the country that he would reveal his Shekinah glory to all mankind. And if you wanted to see God's glory, you had to go to Israel. Are y'all out there, please? When they built the temple, 2 Chronicles 6, Solomon makes an end of praying and the dedication service, and the very next chapter in 2 Chronicles 7:1 says, and when Solomon made an end of praying, the fire came down and the glory filled the temple. But by the way, the Shekinah glory was there before the temple. You know the history of the Jews. The Shekinah glory was with them those 40 years they were in the desert. Can I have some help, you Bible students out there? Because there was a fire by night and a cloud by day. Shekinah glory. God has revealed his glory in the nation of Israel. And God in his sovereignty chose the nation of Israel for another reason. He chose the nation of Israel to be the channel through which his son, Israel's Messiah, and the Savior of the world would be born. Amen. He didn't choose Nashville, Tennessee, home of country western. He didn't choose Arlington, Texas, the home of the loser Cowboys when they got rid of Tom Landry. Oh, quit it, Donovan. Get it. But God chose Israel to be the channel through which his son, Israel's Messiah, and the Savior of the world would be born, crucified, buried, rose again. And he's coming back one of these days, that tiny little country. God has revealed his glory in six ways. Glory in his creation. Glory in his chosen people. Number three. By the way, we had to go to number three. Look up here. There's got to be a number three. You know why? You know why there's got to be a number three? Because Israel turned their back upon God, and God wrote Ichabod over the nation of Israel. His glory is departed. Are you out there, America? The glory used to be in our country, too, not anymore. People would travel all over the world to come to America because they heard about the glory of God that rested upon this place. Are you out there, America? Sure, the glory of God is still here in certain churches, in certain places, but for the most part, Ichabod's written over this nation now. You got rotten leaders like Kamala Harris and Joe Biden. I guarantee you no glory in Washington, D.C. right now. Get some of that Larry Brown in. Look up here, please. There's no more glory. I've been there 14 times. Many of y'all been with us. Go over there. You're going to look for the glory. But for the most part in Israel, it's not there. It's in a few places. And those of you who get to go with us this next year, the glory of God is always in the Garden of Gethsemane. And we'll spend 1 hour, our group will spend 1 hour in the garden where Jesus prayed. Nobody, no interruptions. 1 hour, you'll get to kneel where Jesus knelt. And the glory is still in that garden. The glory is still in that empty tomb. Oh, there's certain places in Israel where the glory is still there. But because Ichabod has been written over Israel. By the way, it's coming back one of these days. God's not finished with Israel yet. Are you out there, please? George Rotten Soros, do you hear me, you Jewish hater? Louis Farrakhan, a Jewish hater? Kamala Harris, you Jewish hater? AOC, Jewish haters? God's not through with Israel yet. Still His chosen people. Don't mess with Israel, because you're messing with the apple of God's eye. But because for the most part, the glory has departed Israel. Thirdly, Jesus came to this earth 2,000 years ago, and there was glory in Christ. Amen. You see, the glory of God was in the Son of God. Say amen to that. 2,000 years ago, that baby born in Bethlehem, the glory of God was there. Oh, not in all of His glory, because nobody could look at Him. Are y'all out there, please? He didn't come 2,000 years ago in all of His glory. If He did, nobody could look at Him. Paul got a glimpse of Him. He was blind for 3 days. Look, this is what the Bible says about His glory right there in the outline. Look at John 1:14. And the Word, that was Jesus, was made flesh and dwelt among us. And we beheld His glory, the glories of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. The glory of God was in the Son of God when He came 2,000 years ago. Even though His glory was veiled, He came in glory. The disciples, Peter, James, and John, got a little glimpse of that glory on the Mount of Transfiguration. What did we do? Look up here, church. What did we do with God's glory? We crucified Him. We crucified the God of glory. That was Friday, but Sunday's coming. And the glory walked out of that grave, spent 40 days on this earth, but now Jesus in all of His glory is sitting at the right hand of His heavenly Father. But guess what? Jesus is not here now. Are y'all listening? Do y'all understand how this works in Bible history? Glory in creation. Glory in chosen people. Glory in Christ. Well, we got to get glory back down here. So number four, there's glory in Christians. Do you know what? You gave your heart and life to Jesus. Some of God's glory came in your life. Say amen to that. The Bible says in 1 Corinthians 6, what? Know you not that your body is a temple of God? You're not your own. You've been bought with a price. Therefore, glorify God in your body and your soul, which belongs to Him. You know what? We're the only glory some people ever see. I didn't say gory. You ought to see what I look at right now. Glory in the Christian. I guarantee if there's more glory in the Christian, we see more people saved. Amen. Number four, God said that's not enough. So let's number five, let's put glory in the church. Amen. Glory in the church. Look what it says there in Ephesians. Number four, glory in the church. I kind of mixed them up, didn't I? Glory in the church, number four. He said, unto Him be glory in the church by Christ Jesus throughout all ages, world without end. I hope when people walk into this place, they'll sense God's glory here. We preached a message last Wednesday night, or 2 weeks ago, on how to get God on us. Some of y'all were here. How to get God on us. And God fell that last Wednesday night, had three people saved. On Wednesday night. Because guess what? When God's on us, His glory is in the house. Things are going to happen. Even on Wednesday night, sir. Larry, you've been with me probably longer than anybody here. Because I met him in 1978. And I buried his first wife, Alma. And I married him and Carol. I buried one of their sons. And he can tell you, we look forward to business meetings. You was at a few of them. We look forward to business meetings at Robin Wood Baptist Church. Did we not, Larry? Would you stand up and tell people, have I talked to you about this? When you walked in, would you stand up? Would you tell these folks what happened in a business meeting? Heaven came down and he's still weeping about it. We'd have a business meeting, people get saved. And our people look forward. Brother Jim, we're going to have another business meeting. That is not Baptistic. Do you hear me, Chris? When God's in the house, people get saved in a Baptist business meeting. We don't fuss and fight like some of you've been used to. I've been to some of these Baptist business meetings. Look like gun smoke on Saturday night. Can I have some help, please? But guess what? When glory is in the house, people are going to get saved. He wants glory in the church. We got to hurry. I got to get to the message. I'm driving to Austin to see my daughter and all my grandkids. We got to get out of town. Number six, there's glory in the celestial kingdom of heaven. Glory in his celestial kingdom in heaven. You know what there's a whole lot of in heaven? God's glory. We just read Revelation 21 and glory's mentioned. Glory, 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 glory. Right on your outline 11 times. How many times? Put it in your outline. 11 times in the book of Revelations, God's glory is mentioned. Oh, woo! Y'all remember the song we used to sing as kids? I got a home in glory land that outshines the sun. All right, that's enough. Good night. Okay, guys, the point is this. We used to sing that little song, I got a home in glory land that outshines the sun. That's not just a little song we taught kids back in my day. It's the truth. It's the truth. Because we got a home in glory land that outshines the sun. And when we get to heaven, woo, what a glorious day that will be. This morning, with the help of God's Holy Spirit, I want us to see some things that await for you and I as God's people. And some of them are already there. I was hoping maybe Brother Warren and Miss Marilyn could watch this online, but guess what? Marilyn's already experiencing it. And she could give me some pointers. I wish I could talk to her. Susan's there, we can only imagine. Enjoying that glory. But I want you to look at your outline. There's three things that await us as God's people in the land of no more forevermores. First of all, there's going to be a glorious revelation soon. A glorious revelation. Guys, anytime Jesus is coming back, you know that. The signs of his coming all around. You don't even have to be a believer to know something's going on. But friends, soon and very soon, we're going to see the King. And that's not just a great song by Andre Crouch, it's the truth. But when Jesus comes again, we'll finally see him in all of his glory. Right now, you and I see Jesus, look up here. Right now, we see Jesus heart to heart. When he comes again, we'll see him face to face. That's what Revelation 22:4 says. We'll see his face. What a revelation that will be. A glorious revelation. Number two, I want you to write in your outline. Notice the no more earthly distractions. No more earthly distractions. You're in Revelation 22. Go to Revelation 21. You're familiar with these verses. You've heard them many times before. You'll hear them many times again. The Bible describes heaven like this in verses 4 and 5. Revelation 21. And God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes. And there shall be no more death, neither sorrow, nor crying, neither should be any more pain, for the former things are passed away. And he that sat upon the throne said, Behold, I make all things new. And he said unto me, Write, for these words are true and faithful. I want you to take a trip with me now. I want you to take a trip with me. We can only imagine what it's going to be like in that land of no mores forever. I want you to take a trip with me. Number one, in heaven, there'll be no more sickness. Seven no mores forever. In heaven, there's no more sickness. I call a young lady every day. I called this morning on the way here. I call her. She's dying of COPD. I led her father to Jesus years ago. Led her to Jesus over the telephone. Many of us miss Normie Toomey. She hadn't been here in months because she's in Arkansas taking care of her dad who's dying right now of leukemia. All the family has gathered all over the country right now outside of Batesville, Arkansas. But I call Debbie every day and I have a short word of prayer with her every day. That's all she can say to me. We have prayer together with Debbie, and when she dies, and I hope she outlives me, I'll drive to Kansas City and do her funeral because she asked me to. When her dad dies, Brian and I are going to drive to Batesville, Arkansas and do a funeral for Normie Toomey's daddy that we had the privilege of leading to Jesus. He's bleeding out of his skin now. My brother died of leukemia. Blood's pouring out of his body. That's why all the family's there. But let me tell you something. One of these days, there'll be no more cancer. One of these days, there'll be no more COPD. One of these days, there'll be no more COVID. One of these days, there'll be no more cirrhosis of the liver, which his wife just died of, sir. Oh, one of those seven no mores forever. Bill's got a mother with stage 4 cancer, dad with dementia. There'll be no more of that stuff when we get to heaven. No more earthly distractions. No more phone calls in the night that my wife just died of cancer. Seven no more forevers. No more sickness. Number two, thank God, Thank God. Put it up there, please. Thank God. Number two, no more sorrow. No more death. Aren't you glad in heaven there's no cemeteries? In heaven there's no tombstones. Here lies Mr. Pease. No more cemeteries, no more tombstones, no more dying there. No more death. Thirdly, I look forward to this one. There'll be no more sin. Some of you act like you don't sin, but you're a liar anyway. 1 John 1 says, if you say you haven't, you're a sin, you're a rotten liar. Are you out there, please? All you little holy Baptists, we all sin. But we have a Savior who's faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness, but we still sin. That's why we had to have an advocate. If we didn't sin, we wouldn't need an advocate right now. You see, when we get to heaven, there'll be no more sin, no more dealing with the world and our old flesh. I guess y'all don't have the old flesh. Your flesh, I want anybody, raise your hand. Anybody here, you have no problem, struggle with your old nature, your old flesh. Anybody here, you're lying, but go ahead and raise your hand because I want to take a picture of you. When you get saved, you get a new nature. We become partakers of God's divine nature, but I still have this old Lord nature. And if the world's greatest Christian struggled with it, so do you, mister. Paul said, wretched I am. I'm a wretched man. The world's greatest Christian said that. Did I do those things I shouldn't do? Those things I should do, I don't. Let me tell you something, cowboy. If the Apostle Paul struggled with it, you and I are too. Woo! Seven no mores forever. No more sin. In heaven, there'll be no more separation. I ask every one of you what to go if you have somebody in heaven. Every one of you raised your hand. You ought to be thankful for this because guess what? In heaven, there's no more goodbyes. You never have to say goodbye to a Christian, but we still say goodbye. They're not here with us. So don't get spiritual on me, okay, cowboy? But one of these days when we get to heaven, there'll be no more separation from mom and dad. No more separation from our children, and our family and friends. I'm looking for that day. Some of you look like you're all sad out about it, but let me tell you, heaven's going to be a nice place. It's a land of seven no mores forever. Number five, thank God there'll be no more suffering. Revelation 21:4 says, no more pain. Jan Botterford is in the hospital at Methodist. She's in pain. I saw her yesterday trying to get her pain down. Can't get the pain down. They rushed Marilyn Glover 2 days ago to ER because she was full of anxiety. Not anymore. There's no pain there. I love what Paul said. Look at your outline. In Romans 8:18, he says, I reckon, y'all read the verse out loud to me. And all God's people said, amen. It'll be worth it all one of these days. It will be worth at all when we see Jesus, all sorrow will be erased when we see Christ. Some of you don't look like you're too excited about going to heaven. But it's a land of seven no mores. Distractions we had to deal with down here. Number six, there'll be no more struggles. Think about it. Susan struggled with alcohol addiction, his wife. She got saved in my office 2007, but her 10-year-old boy was killed in a car accident. For 14 years, she struggled with that alcohol addiction. She didn't want to drink. She struggled with it. We love Susan. But guess what? May 23rd, her struggling's over with. I buried Tommy Westbrook's son, Chris Westbrook, who struggled with that drug addiction. I loved that boy. And when he wasn't on drugs, he was the greatest Christian young man you'd ever see in your life. He struggled with it. And finally, God called him home as a young man because he just couldn't do it anymore. And I mentioned yesterday in this service, some of our greatest heroes in the Bible had personal witness. I want y'all to look up here at me. I don't know what everybody's staring down at your notes for. I shared yesterday in the service, some of our greatest heroes in the Bible, many of them had personal weaknesses and major mishaps. So if they struggled, so will you and I. But thank God, there's no empty tank of God's mercy and grace. No empty tank in God's mercy and grace for those who are struggling down here. I'm grateful I got Jesus, young man, because guess what? I couldn't handle it without him. Seven no mores forever. The last one. Thank God when we get to heaven, there'll be no more scars. There'll be no scars. Look at your outline, please. When we get to heaven, there'll be no more wounds or bruises from this old world. Would you get the lights? I'm not ready for you to do the song yet, but get the lights. That way you can't write on your notes and look at the song at the same time. I want everybody to look up here. The only scars in heaven won't belong to me and you. I'm going to say that again because you didn't get it. The only scars in heaven won't belong to me and you. This song is going to bless you if you want a blessing. If not, take about a 3.5-minute nap. But look up here. If I'd only known that Tiffany was going to die on Saturday, when she walked in Friday night from that church softball game, Kathy and I were up. We hugged her, as we do all of our kids. We kissed her on the cheek, as her daddy always did. My girls got a lot of kisses and hugs from their daddies. And when I see my 50-year-old daughter in a few minutes, and Austin, I'll hug and kiss my 50-year-old daughter. If I can catch my grandkids, I'll do the same thing to him. But that kind of grosses them out. But I don't really give a rip. Amen. But you think about your loved one right now. What if, wouldn't you like to have just one more day? Just one more day with your mama? If you knew the next day she was going to, if you knew just one more day, then you must not have had the kind of mother I had. Shorty, I can't help it. That's just the truth. Look at you, proud for you too. Because the same grace for me is the same grace for you. But you got a daughter there you wish you could have hugged one more day, okay? Look up here, please. Brenda, I told your husband, Butch,
I looked at your mother's picture this week. And I thought about Susan. And I think about Marilyn. And I want you to listen to the words. And I pray the Holy Spirit of God will minister to you right now. Turn it up, please.
One more day with you. Cause there's a wound here in my heart where something's missing. And they tell me that it's gonna heal with time. But I know you're in a place where all your wounds have been erased. And knowing yours are healed is healing mine. The only scars in heaven that won't belong to me and you. There'll be no such thing as broken, and all the old will be made new. And the thought that makes me smile now, even as the tears fall down, that the only scars in heaven are on the hands that hold you now. I know the road you walked was anything but easy. You picked up your share of scars along the way. Oh, but now you're standing in the sun. You fought your fight and your race is run. The pain is all a million miles away. The only scars in heaven, it won't belong to me and you. There'll be no such thing as broken, and all the old will be made. Thought that makes me smile now, even as the tears fall down, is that the only scars in heaven, yeah, are on the hands that hold you now. Not a day goes by that I don't see you. You live on in all the better parts of me. Until I'm standing with you in the sun, I'll fight this fight and this race I'll run. Until I finally see what you can see. Oh, the only scars in heaven won't belong to me and you. There'll be no such thing as broken, and all the old will be made new. And the thought that makes me smile now, and even as the tears fall down, is that the only scars in heaven on the hands that hold you now.
that doesn't touch you, your heart is hard. Every head bowed, every eye closed. Every head bowed and every eye closed. As Kathy and Becky begin to play softly, please. Heaven gets sweeter every day for us as God's people. Because Jesus is there. Because our loved ones are there waiting for us. But let me tell you, there'll be no heaven for you, sir. There'll be no heaven for you, ma'am. I don't care if you're in Central America. Texas, it don't matter. You have to have a personal relationship to Jesus Christ. Your name's got to be written in the Lamb's Book of Life. There are some of you here this morning, those who are watching online. You believe in Jesus. You do. But there's some here today, online and here at Cornerstone, that your name's never been written in the Lamb's Book of Life. The only way it'll ever be written, my friend, is not joining somebody's church or being baptized in somebody's water or saying, well, I went to Sunday school as a little girl. You're here today, online, here at Cornerstone, and God's Holy Spirit has spoken to your heart. The Bible says that if whosoever shall confess with their mouth the Lord Jesus, whoever will believes in their heart that God's raised you from the dead, you can be saved today. And heaven will be yours someday. Some of you need to pray this prayer with me. You can't even remember when you got saved. Well, you remember when you was born. You never forgot that, did you? How could you ever forget the greatest day of your life? When Jesus took a hell-bound sinner like me and a hell-bound sinner like you and gave us eternal life, that's the greatest day. If you don't have one of those days, but today on June 13, 2001, God's recording angels got that Lamb's Book of Life open. If you'd like to make a commitment to Jesus, next time someone asks you a Christian, you can say, you know what, June 13th, 2021, I made that commitment to Jesus. Would you pray this prayer with me in your heart at home? Would you pray with me this morning here at Cornerstone? Would you pray this prayer? Dear Jesus, I know I'm a sinner. Without you, I know I'm lost. But today, dear Jesus, ask you to forgive me of all my sins. Right now, Lord Jesus, ask you to come into my heart and be my Lord and my Savior. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for saving my soul. In Jesus' name. Heads are bowed and eyes are closed. At home, you prayed that prayer. There's a number on your screen right there. Would you call that number? We have a young lady who would love to have a word of prayer with you and thank God for your decision. If you're here at Cornerstone this morning, you prayed that prayer in your heart. One of the ways you know that prayer was real, you'll never be ashamed of Jesus. Say, Pastor, I prayed that prayer today. I got my reservations in. I'm not ashamed. If you prayed that prayer, would you raise your hand? Anybody just raise it high? Anybody here? Say, Pastor, I prayed that prayer. In a few moments, we're going to ask you to come.
We got some here today who are joining the church. We're going to ask you to come right now. We're going to ask you to come. There's some of you who say, you know what, we need a church home. We're going to join the church today. Some of you need a church home, mister. We all need a church home. Some of us maybe just want to come to the altar and thank Jesus that He's building a home in glory land for you and I that outshines the sun. Maybe you'd just like to come to the altar and thank Him. I hope you never get so old-fashioned here at Cornerstone that we don't use the altar. I guarantee you, well, no revival comes when altars are full. Everybody look up here. Some of you ladies go over here with Diane Seaton. Don't run away, Diane. Some of you ladies follow her over there. David is home. He's got cancer. They put a feeding tube in him this week. I want to pray for David Seaton. Y'all, ladies, some of you ladies go pray with him. That's plenty, guys. We got others we want to pray for. We got others we want to pray for. I want to pray for Jan Botterford. I want to pray for Jan Botterford. Could some of you ladies come up to the altar and pray with me for Jan Botterford? Come on, ladies. Now, Debbie, I want you to lead that prayer. You and your class been ministering to her. Some of you ladies come up here. Let's pray right over there with Debbie, right over there. But some of us come, you men, come and join Shorty. Pray for Warren Glover. Y'all come and pray for Warren Glover. Rest of us, look up here. Come here, Wayne. That's enough, guys. I want us to pray for Brother Wayne and his family. George, I lift this family up to Jesus. We buried his wife yesterday. I want to pray for Wayne, George, Jan, Chris, all the family. Lift them up to Jesus.
I come, I confess, bowing here, I find my rest. Without you, I fall apart. You're the one that guides me.
Oh God, how and it's spreading like a wildfire.